Blessed morning to everyone, and it's good for us to be together as God's children in his home, be served by him with his gifts of life and salvation. We are going to follow the Divine Service Setting 3, beginning on page 184 in the front part of the hymnal. We begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserved your temporal and eternal punishment. I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them. And I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor, sinful being. Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you, and in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Take us away the sin of the world. Receive our prayer. Of God the Father, have mercy upon us. For thou only art holy, thou only art the Lord, thou only. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, your Son willingly endured the agony and shame of the cross for our redemption. Grant us courage to take up our cross daily and follow him wherever he leads, through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Please be seated for our readings.
The lessons for the 14th Sunday after Pentecost is from Jeremiah chapter 15. O Lord, you know, remember and visit me, and take vengeance for me on my persecutors. In your forbearance, take me not away. Know that for your sake I bear reproach. Your words were found, and I ate them, and your words became to me a joy and the delight of my heart. For I am called by your name, O Lord, God of hosts. I did not sit in the company of revelers, nor did I rejoice. I sat alone because your hand was upon me, for you had filled me with indignation. Why is my pain unceasing, my wound incurable, refusing to be healed? Will you be to me like a deceitful brook, like waters that fail? Therefore, thus says the Lord, if you return, I will restore you, and you shall stand before me. If you utter what is precious and not what is worthless, you shall be as my mouth. They shall return to you, but you shall not turn to them. This is the word of the Lord. It continues. And I will make you to this people a fortified wall of bronze. They will fight against you, but they shall not prevail over you, for I am with you to save and deliver you, declares the Lord. I will deliver you out of the hand of the wicked and redeem you from the grasp of the ruthless. The epistle for today comes from Romans chapter 12. Let love be genuine, abhor what is evil, hold fast to what is good. Love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not be slothful in zeal. Be fervent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in tribulation. Be constant in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints and seek to show hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be hoity, but associate with the lowly. Never be conceited. Repay no one evil for evil, but give thought to do what is honorable in the sight of all, if possible. So far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. To the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. For by doing so, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. This is the word of the Lord. Please rise for the gospel reading.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 16th chapter. From that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, far be it from you, Lord, this shall never happen to you. But he turned and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan, you are a hindrance to me, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man. Then Jesus told his disciples, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his life? Or what shall a man give in return for his life? For the Son of Man is going to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay each person according to what he has done. Truly, I say to you, there are some standing here who will not taste death until they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. This is the gospel of the Lord. Having heard the word of the Lord, let's join together and confess the faith. We'll use the words of the Nicene Creed on page 191. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, who is not the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated for the hymn of the day. we pray. May the words of my lips and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Brothers and sisters in Christ, there in your bulletin is an insert with the verses. The passage which we're going to meditate upon this morning is free from the lectionary, our readings for this morning, for this particular Sunday in Pentecost, after Pentecost, but from Proverbs 30, verses 24 through 28. Four things on earth are small, but they are exceedingly wise. The ants are a people not strong, yet they provide their food in the summer. The rock badgers are a people not mighty, yet they make their homes in the cliffs. The locusts have no king, yet all of them march in rank. The lizard you can take in your hands, yet it is in king's palaces. And this is our text. Please be seated. And you'll see there are also some points of our meditation that we'll go over together here this morning as we're together. And there is a summary of our readings as normal. But one thing I want to point out to you, there is right in there an explanation and a reference to the theology of the cross as opposed to the theology of glory. And this is a very, very important thing for us as Christians and as a church to recognize. And our readings for this Sunday really help us to understand the difference and the importance of understanding that difference. So take note of that throughout the week. Pray about it. Brothers and sisters in Christ, what a gift God has given us in sunshine. It's absolutely amazing. Every day the sun is there and God gives us light with it, with its light and warmth, what all life needs on a daily basis. You know, and it's not that we take sunshine for granted and the sun for granted. We know the sun's value. We know the importance. But the thing of it is, when we're going about our daily duties and going about our tasks for the day, we don't spend much time, if any time at all, thinking about how the sun is there providing us the sunshine that we need. So, yet it's the sun's value and importance that we, if you notice this, we easily notice its value and importance at two points in the day. One when it's rising and the other when it's setting. And these are very beautiful parts of the day. When it is rising, it reminds us of the gift of the day lying ahead of us. A day which the Lord has made, in which we can serve him, serve others with that joy and that cheer that he's shared with us through Christ. And when the sun's rising, we're reminded to give thanks to the Lord for his mercy that he promises to be every morning. And then when the sun is setting, once again, it gives us pause to look back on the day that we just had, and give thanks to the Lord for his faithfulness, his steadfast love, all through that day, up to that point in the evening, and to use that pause to know that the Lord is there to hear your prayer, to hear your repentance, to be assured of his word of forgiveness for the sins of that day. And because of that forgiveness, you may go to sleep in peace. And so today, after a summer break, Sunday school at Bethel Lutheran begins here for a new year. You know, someone once said, as the sun is best seen at his rising and setting, so what is in people is clearest seen when they are children and when they are dying. A person's life is most noticeable at birth and at death. It's not that we don't value the person's life any less all the days in between that. But yet when a child is born and when a person departs in death, that's when we really notice the gift of human life. When a child is born, the parents, the family, the church is elated over what lies ahead for that child in his or her life. Years, each full of day, the gift of days in which that person will be able to live as a child of God, made that way in holy baptism, and serve the Lord, pick up that cross, and follow his or her Lord all the days of life. And so when a person is departing this life by death, it gives pause to look back upon that person's life and thank God for his mercy all those years and all those days, for the Lord's faithfulness and steadfast love, and to be assured of God's word of forgiveness of sins that allows that person to depart this life in peace. And when we look upon the children of our congregation, let it be a reminder to all of us that really we are children of God by way of his promise and holy baptism. All of us. Let it be a reminder of the prayerful support and the encouragement we ought to give to parents in raising children in that baptismal life given to their children, that identity in Jesus Christ. Everyone here, everyone ought to give that support, that encouragement to parents. For all of us as children of God, really, we are small in this world. But yet we are blessed to live in the wisdom of Christ. All by grace through faith, a gift from God.
It's nice in Proverbs, I'll read that first verse again, where think
they are exceedingly wise. And here our Lord's chief purpose in calling attention to the wisdom of ants and rock badgers and locusts and lizards is no different from the aim of such things in congregations such as Sunday school. God wants us to be wise unto salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. As you see there on the bottom of the insert from 2 Timothy 3, verses 14 through 17, but as for you, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, and how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. And all Scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. So thinking about the four creatures in our text, starting with the first one, ants, they're very weak compared to people. They and their little hills that they form are no match for your feet or your car tire or your lawnmower tire. But in spite of that weakness, they are wise because they prepare their food in the summer when the time is there to prepare that food and gather it. When they find that food that is needed, they tug at it with all their strength at something often so much larger and heavier than they are. And if needed, other ants come to help that one ant. And often we see two lines, a line of ants with empty hands going away from the supply of food that they just made, and another ant carrying food to that supply. They work all summer, never taking a break. They are wise in this because they know the winter is coming when this stockpiling of food is really going to matter to them. The thing of it is, they make use of their time to prepare for time of need. Ants only need food for their bodies. You and me as people, we're different. We need food for our bodies too, but yet we need more than food for our bodies. We need the bread and the water of life for our souls, and that of the very word of God. When we remember the children among us, we also remember that as children of God, all of us, it is actually unsafe and it is unwise and it is foolish for us to wait until later in life to take seriously the word of God and his means of grace, his word and sacraments. The reason is, it's because our sinfulness, because of the temptation, it's always with us. Also, because death is unpredictable, because none of us know of the day or the hour of the Lord's return. It is unwise and unnecessary to put off God's word and his sacraments, even if it be a week or a day. This first thing reads there, although small on earth, the wise in Christ, first one, prepare themselves with the word of God and his sacraments. The kingdom of God is at hand. Now is the time. So now about rock badgers. They're not mighty and strong animals. Yet they are wise in that they make their homes in rocks. They have short legs, short ears, they're timid, they're wary. They come out in the morning and the evening most of the time to come out to eat, and they stay together. They are weak, they're vulnerable, yet they are wise to take shelter in the rocks, safe from predators, safe from weather, We notice that because as children of God, we are weak and we are vulnerable, to, especially to one thing, and that is our own sinfulness and to the temptations that come our way every day. As children of God, we must remain with the Word of God that reminds us of some very important things. One is that our daily sin acts as if God is our enemy and that we are friends with the devil. That's not something to ignore, but to treat and to be ministered to by the Word of God. But also, too, to remind you that God's wrath towards sin and his enemies is real, and that from his wrath, you and I, we need shelter. And wisdom in Christ, which we have received in holy baptism, provides us that shelter. And it's not made of wood or clay or straw. It is made of rock. Second thing in the notes, although small on earth, the wise in Christ. Second one, seek refuge in Christ, the rock. And the locusts, referred to in our text, they differ somewhat from the locusts we're used to hearing and seeing here in America. The locusts in our text, they lay eggs in the reeds of the river deltas, wherever they are, and they hatch and they grow, and when they've developed the ability to fly, they go far away in swarms that are unbelievably thick and unified. And really, as much as they've been studied, there's no answer the world can give as to why these locusts travel such great distances in such great numbers. If we think about bees, they swarm, but they are visibly led by a queen. American locusts, they seek out new territory when the food source where they are becomes scarce and they need to move on because of that reason. But for these locusts in our text, there is no visible, explainable reason for their travel and their swarming in such great numbers to the world. It's just a mystery. Great lesson for us as children of God to point out a truth for us, that as children of God, we do have a king. It's just not a king the world can see. Children of God know that the time in heaven comes when we will actually see our King, our Lord, with our own eyes. That now is the time to live by faith in our Lord, for the time in heaven will be a time when we live by sight in our Lord. Children of God, we have been given the wisdom of Christ to know it is unwise and foolish to live any day of life without Christ and His Word. To go any length of time or days or weeks without the Word of God, His means of grace offered freely in His church. To go any length of time or days or weeks without repenting of our sin and receiving absolution that our sins are forgiven before the Lord. Children of God, know that as the locus of our text, we are not to be alone, but to remain together with others of God's kingdom. And that if you resist the Lord and go your own way, you will perish. But if you remain with Him and His church, you will remain safe. And that not only that you are with the army of the Lord, and that together with all of His people, you are part of God's church with a message from God for the world that turns the wisdom of this world upside down. That like the locusts, alone we can do little or nothing, but yet together with the Lord, what the church can do is amazing. The third point there, although small on earth, the wise in Christ, number three, remain in the church and march in the Lord's army. And why do we march in the Lord's army together? Well, it keeps us together. Keeps us mindful of the purpose and who we are, and that others may have the freedom in Christ from their own sin, from death, and from the power of the devil that you and I have and enjoy and take comfort in. You know, anyone who cares to have a clean home free of pests does not tolerate a lizard in the home. These little creatures can climb walls and live in places that are out of reach, out of sight. They're not welcome necessarily in a clean home, yet they find their way there, and they find a way to stay there. And yeah, you can take a lizard in your hand, and you can throw that lizard out. Yet, as the text says, they live in kings' palaces. They find a way. They know the way to be there. Children of God are not all that welcome in the world. Yet God provides us the way to be here. The world would like to clean house of Christians, of believers in Christ. But yet while we may not be welcome in this world, we do belong to the kingdom of God, and there is a place prepared in his mansion for us to dwell forever. And also, just as a lizard can grip what it needs to, so has the child of God been provided the hand of faith. And that hand of faith is for a particular reason, that is to reach and grab hold of the gifts that Jesus has won for us in his suffering and death. To reach out and grab hold of the forgiveness of sins offered freely by God. To grab hold of eternal life and all of the riches of heaven, of his mansion, of his palace. He freely offers from his hand. And all of that, every bit of it, paid for and prepared by the blood of Christ, Lamb of God. And the last thing reads there, all those small on earth, the wise in Christ take into their hands all things of great value in God's kingdom. And because of that hand of faith, we can behold all that God provides and know with certainty that we don't have to look to any other God. We know with certainty that it is actually foolish to look to another God when we have a God as we do. And Martin Luther, in regard to the first commandment, to have no other gods, that we should fear, love, and trust in God above all things, he refers to the faith of a child that is able to keep this commandment because of Christ. And brothers and sisters in Christ, we are called upon by God to support parents, support families, in what takes place in the home, among those of the household, to give that support, that prayerful encouragement to parents in raising their children, what they have received fully and completely in holy baptism, to raising their children in the promise received in it, that they are whole, that they are complete in Christ, that they don't need to look to anything in this world to make that completion of who they are in Christ, that they are one, they're one baptism, have received all they need for their relationship with God. And that it is not only wise and necessary to remain in the church, to remain in God's word, and to remain with his means of grace, but that it is also the privilege and honor to be a member of the family of God. Parents, you are your child's primary instructor in the faith. Call upon the Lord. Remain in his church, that you have the help and the support and the encouragement God provides through his church and his people. Children, know that you are loved by God and by everyone here. And I speak not only to the young children here, but to all the children of God, saying, remain wise in Christ as you have been made to be in holy baptism. Grow as a child of God in his word and sacraments. And as the rising sun reminds us of what lies ahead for that day, let's be reminded of how we were brought into the kingdom of God by baptism, to be children of God, to remain with his means of grace, found in the church, prepared for the days ahead, anticipating our heavenly home with him. Until then, we stay together as his church, as his people, marching and living this life together, with a message that turns the wisdom of this world upside down in the hope that others too can have that comfort and peace of God that we have received by way of forgiveness of our sins before our Lord. And then as the sun sets in the west each day, be reminded of how the Lord remains with us every day. That when the time comes, that same forgiveness of sins provides you the peace you need to depart this life. It doesn't matter, really, if we are a congregation of 8,000 adults and only one child. It doesn't matter if we are a congregation of 100 adults and 80 of them are, and then there are 80 children among us. Let's joyfully and cheerfully take on the responsibility we all have as children of God, pick up that cross, follow him, and support parents and their children to be wise and to salvation in Christ Jesus. Every one of us not only has this responsibility, but we also have this as a privilege and an honor in Christ Jesus as his own. God bless us all as we cheerfully take on these Christian duties. God bless parents, children, our Sunday school teachers, and all members of this congregation that we live prepared in what we have already received and the peace to depart in Christ in the faith. That's the way to live in Christ. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which passes all of our understanding, keep and guard our hearts and minds in and through Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Would you please rise? Let's join together and sing in the offertory you'll find on page 192. Please be seated for the gathering of our offering to the Lord. Would you please rise for prayer? Each of our petitions conclude with, Lord, in your mercy, congregation's responses, hear our prayer. We pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Almighty Avenger, teach your faithful ones to trust so fully in your fatherly care that they seek not vengeance but mercy. Stoke our zeal to bless those who curse us and so heap holy coals upon their heads. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, you have made us feast on your word to the delight of our hearts, and keep us from the worldly company of revelers who despise your word, and inspire the pastors of your church to brazenly proclaim what is precious, the gospel of your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, open wide the hearts of Christians to one another, especially within the home and between neighbors. Let love be genuine, speech truthful, and patience constant. Let us commend ourselves in everything as those by God's love and therefore unashamed to serve one another. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, grant to our homes your grace and blessing that they may be places of nourishment and faithfulness to your holy word. Give to parents the joy of their vocation, leading them to instruct their children in the true faith, providing for their physical needs as well. And as we begin Sunday school here at Bethel, lead families to take hold of the opportunity. Grant to our teachers the joy and faithfulness to your word, the willingness to teach, and wisdom to do so. Grant to students willingness to learn knowledge of your word, and provide this congregation a joy and cheer in supporting such efforts as Sunday school, looking to you and supporting and encouraging every family with children. Lord, in your mercy, and preserve our nation, its leaders, and those who serve for the good of our people and for their protection. Grant peace in our time, O Lord, for you alone fight for us. Lord, in your mercy. And great physician, heal and restore. We especially remember lift up to you those we name in our hearts who need the assurance of your grace and mercy. Provide healing in any way according to your good, gracious, and wonderful will. We ask that you behold the family of Pastor Elsner, who you have called home to be with you. Be with the family as they grieve at his death. Be with those, and we name in our hearts, who suffer in any way. And we include those in our prayer and lift up to you those who have suffered any kind of loss from the current hurricane. And we thank you for the protection that you have given, Lord, in your mercy. Lord, lead us to repentance and faith, that we might not think more highly of ourselves than is right, but that we would set our hearts and set our minds on the things of God. Prepare us to receive the blessed gifts of our Lord's table, by which you preserve us holy and blameless in Christ until he comes. Lord, in your mercy. Rise up, O Lord, and avenge those who are persecuted for the name of your Son, Jesus. In communion with all your saints, grant us endurance to bear our crosses as Christ bore his for us. Lord, in your mercy. All these things and whatever else you know that we need, grant us, Father, for the sake of him who died and rose again and now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let's continue with the service of the sacrament you'll find on page 194. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God. It is truly meet, right, and salutary that we should at all times and all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who out of love for his fallen creation humbled himself by taking on the form of a servant, becoming obedient unto death, even death upon a cross. Risen from the dead, he has freed us from eternal death and given us life everlasting. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, taught by our Lord and trust in his promises, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Lord Jesus Christ, in the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take."